be over them.
Our truth, I perceive that God is no respect of person. But in every nation that fears and worships righteousness, that nation is acceptable unto him. Found in the book of Acts, the 10th chapter. Paul, Peter, rather, set forth the idea that the Jews were not the only ones that God favored, but Gentiles were favorable if they are willing to do what the will of God called for. And Paul preached the gospel to those at Rome. He said, "I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth, first to the Jew and also to the Greek." Is that right?
Yes.
And he put it this way, when it comes to what the gospel has for us, you see what therein, he's talking about the gospel, therein is the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith, that the just shall live by faith. And so this morning we come because the goodness and the mercy of God has been extended to all nations.
Amen.
Jesus rose from the dead, he told the people, the apostles, the disciples, he said, go into all the world and preach the gospel to how many? Every creature. He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved. Matthew's account said, go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things. And he said, lo, I'll be with you always, even unto the end of the age. So we are privileged this morning to be disciples, be Christians, because of the goodness and the mercy of God. And I trust and pray that we don't take it lightly, because there are many today who are sharing this privilege. But God wants us, as members of his body, to share this good news with the whole world. Amen.
Amen.
If you don't know what the mission of the church is, then the mission of the church is for members, as we are baptized into the body of Christ, is to go out and share this good news with those who are not in the body of Christ. Amen.
Amen.
Now, in order to do this, there has to be a sense of not only urgency, but a sense of need on the part of us to realize that if we don't do it, who will do it? Amen.
Amen.
And involved in that, we would come to the conclusion that we ought to share the gospel with others, because everyone deserves to have this good news. God is no respecter of person. And so if they have an opportunity to do our share in the gospel, we should be happy. And our happiness will basically not only start over here, but it will transcend to over there. Amen.
Amen.
You ask the question, Brother Kenneth, everybody will be happy over there. Well, if they're not happy over here, will they be happy over there? I think the happiness starts over here and it'll transcend to over there. Amen. That's why when we come to the service of God, we ought to show happiness and show joy in our life. And I'm looking at you because unless you are sick like I was this week, you should have some gaiety. Amen. You ought not be frowning like we've been eating on sour lemon. You ought to be happy.
Amen.
We're in a place where God is here with us today. Jesus said, where two or three gather together in my name, he said, what?
I will be in the midst.
There I am in the midst. And so he's here. And if Jesus is here, we ought to be happy. Amen.
Amen.
Great to see all of those who are present. Some missed for the last couple of weeks. I've been here and I wondered where they were, so I'm letting you know I missed you. Amen. Glad to see you here this morning. And hope and trust that we
building on some things that would help be for the good of this congregation in the, not only in the days to come, but in for the years that will be ahead of me. Last Sunday, I preached on the subject of 1 Corinthians chapter 9, and I pointed out that Paul was defending his apostleship relative to the support that the apostles were receiving, and he himself and Barnabas were struggling because some felt that they were not apostles, and then being not apostles, they didn't feel that they had a right to support them. But Paul went on to show them that they was as much apostles as the ones in Jerusalem. And those in Jerusalem were receiving support. And he said that when it comes down to it, you cannot discriminate against one apostle or against another. Amen? It is right to support the apostles in Jerusalem. And Paul said, am I not an apostle? Then it's right to support us, Barnabas and I. We are preaching the word of God. But the question had come up relative, because they were working, that they were not worthy of the support. But Paul said the reason that he didn't get their support is because he didn't want the gospel to be hidden, to be hindered by people who basically would have trouble with trying to support the preacher. But he had to teach them that there was always in God's plan support for the ministry.
Amen.
Y'all remember that? And he pointed out, but he did it just so that the gospel wouldn't be hindered. And it's good when you can find individuals who can support themselves as they preach the word of God. But there's nothing wrong with a church who will have a minister, or if it has grown to the point that it can support more than one minister, for them to do that. I'll be just from here and there giving little tidbits here, but it's even good when you have a church that's fully developed, where you got elders, and an elder can be put on salary to be supported. Amen. And it's not the preacher, but elders, the preaching elders should be supported. And that he's given himself over to the work. And so the idea of supporting the minister is what the ninth chapter Paul was dealing with, and that pointed out that the Bible holds up the fact that an ox, if he plows, then he must eat that what he said? The ox must not be loved. And also the soldier who goes out to war must be supported. Not by his own expense, for no man goeth out to war and he doesn't do it. So we talked about three things that happens when it came to the support. And that last one was the one of the temple, that the one of the temple ate of it, which was brought for sacrifice at the temple. And so that we tried to point out to you. Now somebody said, well, what are you doing it for? Because number one, it needs to be taught to the church, that the church has responsibility. Now, if you're a member of the church, amen, if you're a member of the church, then we're talking to you. We're not talking to those who are not the member, we're talking to members, letting members know that you have a responsibility to support the ministry of the church. Ministry of the church. Now, it's good when you have a minister who can basically be supportive of himself, but there are very few who can support themselves. They need help. Amen. And then along that way, I put it this way, sometimes the minister can help himself, and then the church can help the minister. Works both ways. They must come together. And such has been the case over the years here, whereby the church has been supportive of me, but at the same time, then I've been supportive of myself, and that I worked and helped support. Amen?
Amen.
And I need to say to the church right now that in the future, you may not be able to have a person to be as fortunate as I have been. That is to come in and work and preach. What every church needs, if they can afford it, is a man that can come in and he doesn't have to work on a job.
Amen. Am I right about it? Doesn't have to work on the job. He can basically be free to do all of those menial tasks that needs to be done, and he's not hampered by simply as a person who's working. He has to work for and support his family. The church, it becomes his support. Mm-hmm. But when you get into that, then it means that the church has to be made to realize that certain person has no other source but you.
Amen.
Amen. If he has a car, it's going to be you helping to support him with it. Amen.
Amen.
And I pointed out something last Sunday. Now, what's going to happen in order to show this so this can happen? Some churches that we have ministered, and I would say in East Texas, is very few preachers that I know of that basically has what we call full-time support, where the minister of the church don't have to work. North Tenney Hall in Tyler is such a one, and of course you get up into Dallas and you have bigger churches there, but in East Texas, most of the ministers, just like I am, they have to help support themselves. Amen.
Amen.
So if you're looking for a minister to take my place, it basically would be kind of hard for a man to come in here and basically be supported by the church. He's going to have to kind of have some work, do some work. Amen?
Amen.
But if you take it on, it's a big responsibility.
Amen.
I was just saying, it's a big responsibility. I mentioned last Sunday to those, I did it for $300 a week, but I was working. If you basically say, we're going to pay a minister $300 a week, and that's all, he's not going to work. He's not going to work. And I pointed out to someone, said, well, $300, that's a lot of money. Is that a lot of money? And when you break it down, we talk about here, supporting him, that's all you give him, and you talk about that. He may be here a couple of weeks, a month, but he gone. Because he has to go to the store. When he go to the store, and even if you was trying to do like you did in the olden days, bring potatoes and stuff like that, help support the preacher, you take him to the store with you, in other words, and you see what you have to spend out, and out of that, you'd be surprised. As I said last week, I think light bread you can get for 60 cents a loaf, can you? Whatever you have, you got to share with them. So if you need a loaf of bread, he needs a loaf of bread. But you know, you can't go in there and then get a discount. The preacher can't ask for a discount. So you have to have some money that when he goes in there. And you take $300 and you expect for him to give out of what he gets, right? Amen. When you get through, that's not a lot of money. As people. Now that was a time, $300, a lot of money. But nowadays, you know that ain't a lot of money. In other words, I told you last, I had to give up on I stuff that I used to compete a nickel for. You can't get a nickel by nothing now. Amen. I don't even buy candy no more. It's just expensive today. Then, and somebody said, well, preacher ought not be eating candy anyway. What if you eat candy? He needs to have candy every once in a while. Amen. So what we're trying to do is let you know that you're going to have to do better. Now, the bottom line, and I'm going to go to my left, but the bottom line is that we need to look at our finances again. And the finances to me, are you doing what you can do? That's the bottom line. And as I said last week, I'm not going to take it back. If you're making $500 a week, and you're giving here $5, you're way below that. You can't have a full-time minister giving like that. But if you want it, you remember how I talked about the lady who went on was the lady or man who went on the parking lot to get him a car? All she had was $3,000, but she ended up on the Cadillac lot.
She was on the wrong lot.
When the man asked what he said, and he told her she had $3,000, she was on the wrong lot.
There you go.
And then finally he told her, said, well, I tell you what, just to be honest with you, he said, I don't know what lot you can go to and get you a car. You may need a motorized bicycle. Why? Because you just can't get nothing. So you got to come up with more money. And most of us, if we're honest, know what I'm talking about. If you do get something, whether you want to pay it or not, if you get it, you're going to have to find ways by which to come up and pay for it. Am I right? And therefore, you got to put things in perspective, you know. Some of us who want that car bad enough, you've been buying 12 suits a year, you're going to have to cut down. 12 dresses a year, you're going to have to cut down. If you're going to get that car that you want so bad, you know, so you're going to have to cut back and do some things. I would suggest to the congregation, look at your finances and this coming year, look at what you can do a little better than you've done this year. In other words, somebody said, well, you mentioned $500. I think a person giving $500 should be at least looking to do better. And what would being doing better would mean from 5 to 50. And I said, woo! Well, that's what some of us over the years who have learned how to give have done. Amen. Those who were giving didn't start out that way. But if you mean well for the church, if God bless you, and He is blessing us, each year you try to do a little better. That means don't crowd the Lord out and have nothing to give to the Lord. The scraps won't get it done. Amen. Anybody know what I mean by scraps? When you get everything you want, and then you have a little left over, then you give it to the Lord. That kind of giving is not going to do it. You got to make up your mind for the Lord first. Amen. And then I challenge you this morning with this. If you put the Lord first, and you may think you can't make it, but if you start even sacrificially giving to the Lord, I say try God. Try Him. And see if He won't make things better for you. Because God ain't going to let you outgive Him. Amen. Just move up. Amen. And so I'm simply saying here, what I'm doing when I say $50, that's 10%. Mm-hmm. Amen. Did that scare you then? Well, if that scared you, you haven't even been to Bible class. Bible class would tell you that you had to do what? A tenth, a tithe. It never has been less than that. It was always a tithe. So if a person was making 50 back under the Old Testament, that means he had to come up $50, you had to come up with five. Somebody says, that's a whole lot of money. But the idea you're giving to the Lord. And when you give to the Lord, He'll bless you. Even people who own an income, like I'm on an income, what's called a fixed income. You got to readjust. Yep. Amen. And I'm here to tell you, when you have a fixed income, some adjustment has to be made. Amen. But if all of us look at what we are trying to do and see what we need to do and do what we can, it can be done. Amen. It can be done. Now, in some churches, when I basically learned how to give, I was in the church where Brother Winston taught the church. He did it in such a way that you would be embarrassed. You call yourself a Christian working every day. As I was working, I had bills, but who made the bills? I made the bills, but he was simply saying here, anybody who's working, they ain't coming, as I was doing and giving 50 cents in the collection. He said, you ought to be shameful. Your giving will determine your God.
Amen.
Did you hear what I say? Your giving will determine how big your God is. If your God can only give you 50 cents a year, well, that's how big your God is. But if you have been blessed, and all of us today have been blessed, are we making more money now than we ever made? Ain't no need of going back to the 50s. Well, in the 50s, you know, they gave 50 cents. Well, the average person back in the 50s, some of them barely made $50 a week. If they made that, they only got 40 cents a day. But I guarantee you, this building here back in 1958 when it was built, somebody back there sacrificed to make sure that this building got built.
Amen.
And it's here today, but we have to go further. So I just wanted to say that to you and let you know that some things can be done and it needs to be done. It's how you feel about it. And I just believe here it ought not be up to one member to try to support the church here.
Amen.
Did I say something wrong then?
No.
One member. We must give as we are prospering. I think I said this last week, I said it again. I was challenged by a minister and said, well, the only way you can teach the church how to give, you got to be the biggest giver in the church. And I said, well, that ain't right. Here, man is making $1,000 a week, and I'm only making $150 a week, and I got to give $50 of that what I'm getting to basically show him that he needs to give more. The Bible doesn't teach that, but I would say this much. You give as you prosper. And the one who's making the money, they certainly ought to be giving more money than the one who's not making it. But it ought to be proportionate. That's it, as God prospers you. So if you're not being prospered $1,000, you can't give $1,000 like a person who has $1,000. But you give what you can give. Amen? Now, let me just clear something up. Somebody said, well, you know, I give, but I don't like to. I think giving ought to be between me and myself. Nobody needs to know what you give. Well, I agree with you, that's between you and God. But if you're ashamed of your giving, then somebody needs to encourage you. Say, well, you're giving. No, we don't need to know, but if it's a shame giving, then you need to come up a little more. Amen. Pastor, anybody up there watching, but when the basket passed, and I know, I've been around here long enough. I need to tell you, working in the oil field, the oil field is going down right now, but what did you do when the oil field was up?
Yeah.
You know? Giving ain't up when the money's there, yeah. But when it's down, you're going to do accordingly. But here you're making big money, and then you're giving it way down. Amen. Some of the sisters here just on welfare, on fixed income, and giving more than some of the fellas making $500 a week. That's a shame. And then, of course, there are some and you're giving a lot more beyond others. And if they start giving, or if that happened like that, what would it be? We all got to pitch in. That's all I'm saying. Do what you can. Now, if you love me like I love you, what I'm saying here, in other words, if it didn't bother you, I mean, it wasn't about you, it went right that. Don't even say I said it. Is that all right? But if it's something that you can use along this way to help the cause of Christ here, that's what it's meant to do. And I would encourage you. I've watched the giving over the years. Our sisters here do well in that giving. Our sisters do well.
Amen. Amen.
Some of our brothers are letting us down. And we need to just shape up, brother. Is that all right? Can I get an amen up there?
Amen.
And I want to tell you this because, number one, I feel like Paul to the Galatians. Because I love you. But I hope because I love you and I tell you the truth, you'll become my enemy. Amen. And I will tell you this, is that the more I live for the Lord, the more I really want to give to the Lord and serve the Lord. I don't want to serve him less. I want to what? Serve him even more. Because he's been too good. Brought me from a mighty long way. Amen. Galatians, rather Acts chapter 19. If I can just sum some things up and we look at Acts 19. In the 18th chapter, Paul had been traveling from city to city, and he had come to this one city there that was called Ephesus. And of course, in the process, before he came to Ephesus, he had gone to Corinth. He had picked up some traveling partner. If you go back to the 18th chapter in the verse 1, the name of Aquila and Priscilla. They were tent makers. And he had banded up with them, and they were actually doing evangelistic work there in the city of Corinth. And the Bible says that as they reasoned, Paul, and they, along with Paul, reasoned in the synagogue every Saturday, that they were actually persuading the Jews and the Greeks. And of course, when Silas and Timothy, Timotheus as you refer to, came in from Macedonia, that Paul was pressed in his spirit that he was to go up toward the city of Jerusalem, because he had taken up a vow that he had to go there. And so, around about verse 9 in the 18th chapter, the Bible says the Spirit of the Lord came to Paul in the night vision and said, "Be not afraid, but speak and hold not thy peace. For I'm with thee, and no man shall set on thee to hurt thee, for I have much people in this city." So Paul stayed in Corinth, baptized a fellow by the name of Crispus and also Gaius. And of course, he gained some more friends there, but there were some who basically he had trouble with. And of course, he stayed there a good while, verse 18, and he left out, and of course, along with him, Priscilla and Aquila, they traveled thence to Syria, and he came to Ephesus. Well, there was another fellow who was down in Ephesus preaching, but he was from a place called Alexandria. He had obeyed the gospel from the standpoint of, at this time, he had knew he was preaching what he knew. The gospel of John is what he knew. Somebody said, "What's the gospel of John?" Well, John's gospel was that which taught baptism for the remission of sin, but it didn't give the Holy Spirit, because when he evidently obeyed the gospel, it was before Christ had sent them on the Great Commission. John's baptism preceded the Great Commission. Am I right about it?
Amen.
It actually took place during the time when Jesus were alive and John was baptizing people. And the Bible says that in one passage, Mark chapter 1 and verse 7, that the baptism that John had was for the remission of sin. But the baptism that one needed was not just for remission of sin, but it was a baptism where Jesus said, "He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved." And then he said, and also in Acts 2, "You shall receive the gift of what? The Holy Spirit." So coupled with baptism for the remission of sin was the gift of the Holy Spirit. Well, here Apollos didn't have that. He had been baptized. So all he was preaching was baptism for remission of sin. And the Bible said that when he was preaching, there was Aquila and Priscilla who was heard him. Amen. And when they heard him, they realized something was wrong with his teaching. And so therefore they took him aside and they taught him more perfect in the way. In other words, they taught him that John's baptism had passed, and that was another baptism that he needed. Am I right about it? What baptism was that he needed? He needed the baptism that Jesus commissioned, where he could get the Holy Spirit. Well, after this, John, Apollos had gone up to Ephesus, and he had not gone up to Ephesus, but there were some who he had taught had gone up to Ephesus, and there they were teaching what he taught. And so what happened, Paul, having come from Corinth, came over to Ephesus, and when he got to Ephesus, 19th chapter now, the Bible says he found certain disciples, and he asked unto them, he said, "Have you received what? The Holy Ghost since you believe?" Are y'all following me here? And these disciples said what? "We have not so much heard whether that be in the Holy Ghost." Well, what's wrong here? You cannot be any better than the teacher. If you haven't been taught, amen, you don't know. Even today, we as members of the body of Christ, we didn't come into the church of Christ just by, something hidden us in the, going by the riverside. We had to be taught. Mm-hmm. And we had to be taught the gospel, because that's what Jesus said in John chapter 6, no man can come unto me except the Father, which has sent me, draw him out, raise him up in the last day. For it is written in the prophet, they all shall be what? They should be taught of God. The Christianity is not a felt religion as much as it's a taught religion. Amen? You're feeling something, but if your feeling don't match up to what the teaching is, you got good feeling, but not the right teaching. And so it says unto you, we have not so much heard whether there be any Holy Ghost. And so as a result of this, Paul said, unto what then were you what? Baptized. In other words, when you ask people today, you've been baptized, you need to have a couple of questions to see if they're on the right track. Number one, he said, have you received the Holy Ghost since you believe? They said, we're not so much heard. Now, members of the body of Christ, if they've been taught right, they know that the commissary with them, that teaching is the receiving of the Holy Ghost. When do we receive the Holy Ghost? And how do we receive the Holy Ghost? That's a good question. How? The mystery of how you receive the Holy Ghost is based upon the fact that have you been baptized right? If your baptism is basically teaching you that baptism puts you in a denomination, wrong teaching. Thus, wrong baptism. Baptism have never put one in the New Testament in a denomination. Amen. From the time baptism was instructed to the apostles, when one was baptized, they were put into Christ. Amen. You can be in Christ, amen, and never have to be in a denomination. Now, my misfortune, there are people who are baptized and because of the teaching, lack of the teaching, they end up in a denomination. And all you have to ask is when you're baptized, where you're baptized, and you ended up in the wrong church. That simply means your instruction has been wrong. Mm-hmm. Amen? Mm-hmm. And so I want to just look at some things here quickly to talk. Unto what then, this is my subject title, unto what then were you baptized? Now, Paul told Timothy on one occasion, study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that need not be ashamed, but what? Rightly divide the word of truth. There are two words that we need to consider when we talk about whether we're on the right track. One is innocent, and the other is ignorant. Amen. Now, innocent simply means not knowing. Amen. You just don't know. And of course, are you not exposed to or you're familiar with? And therefore, because you're not exposed to familiar to it, then you're not responsible for it. Let me give you an example. Do babies have to be baptized? Why? They're innocent. They're innocent. Even at the point where they're exposed to, but they can't understand. Jesus said, whoever cometh unto me in the verse must be what? Let's go back over that again. Follow me now. No man can come unto me except the Father which has sent me, draw him out, raise him up in the last day. For it is written in the prophet, they all shall be what? Can we all say that together? That must be some teaching. Now, why do we not baptize babies? They can't be taught. They're innocent. They can't be taught. Even if you teach them, they don't understand. Now, that's what's wrong with denominationalism and I think Catholicism when they have people say, let's baptize a Christian. They're really not baptizing them. You know, they really baptize them. Probably some of them would drown every one of them. Because they don't believe in death, put them underwater. And if you baptize, you got to take them underwater. You at least give them a chance by which they can basically help you if you get them down and you can't get them up. But they sprinkle water upon it. Sprinkling in the Bible has never been acceptable. God didn't tell them, go ye therefore and sprinkle. They go ye therefore and baptize. That means immersion. And so you don't baptize babies. They're innocent. Well, let me go a little further. What about people who basically don't have the understanding? I don't like to use that word. It sounds so bad, but they used to use it a lot more. Imbecile. What is an imbecile?
I think about it, when I hear people call somebody see like an imbecile, it sounds like a bad word, doesn't it? But an imbecile simply means that understanding is not up to par. Mm-hmm. And you can't really hold them responsible. They are not responsible. Is that all right?
Amen.
Puts them in a state where they're innocent. The person that Jesus said must be baptized, he must be able to be taught. Every man therefore that have heard and learned. If you can't learn, in other words, you have no need of being baptized as the Great Commission is teaching it. And so here, Jesus is simply saying, no man can come unto me. He must be able to be taught, he hear, and he learn of the Father cometh unto me. All right?
Amen.
Now, somebody say, well, what about the scripture in the Bible that says, I was shapen in iniquity and sin did my mother conceive me?
Mm-hmm.
That's what denomination used to justify baptizing babies. That when you're born in sin.
Mm-hmm.
Now, did David say that he was born a sinner? He said, I was born, I was shapen in iniquity, and sin did my mother conceive me. Mm-hmm. Who did the sinning?
Mother.
Did y'all follow that?
Mm-hmm.
My mother conceived, and sin did my mother. And of course, I won't talk too much about that. That's a lot of that have gone on in our world. But people are here because it's not here. You know, ain't nothing wrong with the baby. But how the baby got here was because of somebody doing something that shouldn't have been done. Yeah, but y'all get quiet here. That word. But you can't put the sin on the baby.
No.
Amen. I was saying, I was talking to some people and it used to be. Used to be. I think everybody here has been so perfect on the life. But some of them know what I'm talking about. Some things that are going on in your life that you wish you could backtrack, bring back, but you can't.
Mm-hmm.
Amen.
Mm-hmm.
I might be here because of sin. My parents, I don't know.
Mm-hmm.
Amen. But it wasn't my sin that got me here if I got to get it the wrong way. Are y'all following this here? I said, it wasn't my sin. I did no sin. But if my mother was involved in something along the way that she should not have been involved in, then I came here through a process by which basically was not proof of our God.
Amen.
It was against God's will. Amen? That's why we ought not put on people something that they can't outlive. If God gives everybody still a chance. Y'all looking at it. I better give you some more scripture. The soul that what? Sinned. Y'all remember that? The soul that sinned, it shall die. Ezekiel chapter 18 and verse 3. Then he goes further. He said, now, the father shall not bear the sin of the son, nor the son bear the iniquity of the father. That simply means that you can't pass sin on. Aren't you glad about that? Even though they did wrong, but they don't pass it on to you. In other words, you got to say, every man is going to have to answer for their own sin. And when does one really become a sinner? When he sins. Sin is a transgression of the law. And being born is not a sin. If being born is a sin, then Jesus was a sinner. Amen. Just being born. But no, being born, you have to do something to become a sinner. Whosoever transgresses the law, that person becomes a sinner. So here, that idea that you're born a sinner and it's transferable, no. You are innocent until such time that you go about to do sin. Are we together on that? So then, from the second word is ignorance. Ignorance. What does ignorance mean? Ignorance means uninformed, unaware. Now if you don't know God until you basically come to know him, you're ignorant. Don't mean you're stupid. There's a difference between stupidity and ignorance. Amen? And all of us, to a great degree, at one time or another, or maybe still ignorant to some things.
Somebody said, well, I went to school and I got a PhD. That don't even give you... Excuse me. Ignorance is something. You don't know everything. The only person who knows everything is God.
Amen.
Amen. And so if you haven't been taught, then you're ignorant. And of course, Paul, when he was at Mars Hill, he came in Acts 17 and said, God, at the time of this ignorance, what are you talking about? Not knowing. That's what I'm getting to. At the time of this, not knowing, because what they were doing, the Bible says they had made inscriptions to unknown God, whom they do worship, what he said, ignorantly. They didn't know. And since you didn't know, it don't mean not stupid. You got to be informed. And so Paul told them, he said, at the time of this, God winked at. That was a time when God would overlook. But he said, but now command men, well, everywhere, not just someplace, he said, but everywhere. And you know, you get into arguments sometimes, and people say, well, what about those folk over they ain't never heard about? Y'all talk about the gospel, they don't know. Well, don't get so tied up on the idea that God can't destroy people because they... God can do what he wants to do.
Amen.
Am I right about it? You just need to study the Old Testament a little bit and what God did over here, and he justified and do what he did, but he took Israel and called them his special people, peculiar, informed them, and then sent them into the land, and what did they do? They drove out some folk who didn't know God. And they were, amen, but now they were given a challenge when they were in the land not to become like they were, that is, worship their God. They were supposed to be in the land trying to get people to know God. And God is looking for the same kind of people today. He doesn't want to call us in to be Christian and then turn out like the world teach us. And, you know, but if you don't know, what you going to do? We ought to know. He said, go to make disciples of all nations. What it means a disciple? A learner. We ought to be learning. We ought to be knowing what God said so we can teach others what God wants to be done. But many times, because you're weak and you don't grow in Christ, you never get strong enough to tell the world that they need to change. See? Amen. So don't ever let them say, you know, yeah, that's a lot of good in the world, but if it ain't good enough, amen. Lady, one time, we were talking about all the denominations. Denominations say, you know, all the denominations got a good in them, so therefore we shouldn't condemn any of them. And y'all might have heard me say that before. I still hold to it. You know rat poison?
Yeah.
What they make rat poison in? They tell me, Brother Mark, they say 98% cornmeal. But it kills a rat. 98%. No, the 98% don't kill a rat. It's 2% poison. It simply means that we have to understand that the world has a lot of good in it, but if you got 2%, all teaching in it. That's what's destroying people. Religious is that. Many times there are people religiously are good people. Right here. These two, and there were 12 men in this 19th chapter of the book of Acts here that needed conversion. Because what? They believed in what John had taught by the Apollos, the teacher. And but when they baptized them, the Bible said, and they was taught right, they obeyed the gospel. But all they lacked, if you look at, they had received baptism for the remission of sin. All they lacked was the Holy Ghost. Well, you wouldn't go away saying that didn't mean very much now that the Holy Ghost is available and you don't obey. Look at the text. When it says here, when they heard this, they were baptized. What did they hear? He said, you haven't received the Holy Ghost since you believed? They say, we haven't heard so much heard of it. Say, what then? What have you all heard? They said, well, we were baptized under John's baptism. John had a good baptism to a point, but now it's no longer valid. What you gonna do? have to give up John's baptism and obey the baptism that Jesus commissioned. Does that make any sense to you this morning? What unto what then have you been baptized? Then finally the word ignorant simply means not knowing. And when a person don't know, then they can't obey the real gospel of Jesus Christ. Let me see if I can close out. They said unto him, John's baptism, if you get a chance, you need to know in the Bible that there are several baptisms. I think you can say about 6 baptisms in the Bible. You have to know which baptism that you need. Back in the Old Testament, that was called a baptism unto Moses. Even if you understood the baptism unto Moses, it's already gone. You can't get it. Amen. It wasn't for us. See, a lot of people say, well, you know, we believe in the Bible. We do too, but do you understand what you have in the Bible? Some things that are there ain't for you. You got to understand which one is for you. So the baptism of Moses was for the children of Israel, and they were being delivered out of Egyptian bondage through the Red Sea. That's already passed. Then that was the baptism where Jesus told his disciples, he said, now, can you be baptized with the baptism that I'm going to be baptized with? They said, yeah. What was that baptism? Baptism of suffering. They were going to have to suffer and to die. Everybody can't have that baptism today. It's already passed. It was for the disciples. Then there was a baptism whereby the Holy Ghost would be given. And a lot of people may step on that today. What do you mean? You shall be baptized with the Holy Ghost. But they don't realize, and it says, and with fire. That's 2 baptisms that he talked about that. Baptism of the Holy Ghost was for the apostles. That would be an outpouring of the Holy Spirit. That happened on the day of Pentecost. Amen. And the word of the Holy Spirit came upon them. Have you seen any of that thing happen like that? No, that happened on the day of Pentecost. How do you know it? Because the signs that were given with the baptism of the Holy Ghost, the tongue basically lit up on the apostles, and they spake as the Spirit gave them others. You don't have that baptism today. That's already passed. It's for the apostles. Well, what about the fire? Brother Hogan always say that if you keep on waiting around, you'll get the fire. That fire baptism hasn't come yet. But then there is what is called water baptism. Well, actually, that's the only baptism that man can administer. When he said, go ye therefore and teach all nations, and baptizing them, and was it the Holy Ghost? No. Was it baptizing fire? No. But they could baptize it. How do you know it's in water? Because Acts chapter 8, the Bible clearly teaches us it's water. As Philip was teaching the eunuch, they came to a what? A certain water. They came to a certain water. And the eunuch said, well, here is water. What does what? Hinder me to be baptized. By the way, I'm dealing with this tonight, the hindering stuff. Amen. Come back tonight, I'm talking about what does hinder me. That's the things that are hindering people today. But here he said, what does hinder me? He said, nothing if I believe. See, belief could hinder you from being baptized.
Amen.
You got to believe Jesus Christ, Son of God. That's why we don't not just tell people, y'all just blame that. No, if a person don't believe in Jesus Christ, we're not going to take him to the water.
Amen.
Amen. You can walk down to this morning. The Bible tells you, yeah, you must make a confession. But if I ask you a question, that do you believe Jesus Christ, Son of God? And you say, no baptism is going to take place.
Amen.
Belief is a part. You got to believe in Jesus Christ as the Son of God. Amen?
Amen?
And if you don't, there's no baptism. He said, yes, I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. Now, when that affirmative came, that he believed in Jesus Christ, then it was in order to baptize. Amen. That brings it back again. Babies need to be asked, do they believe Jesus Christ, Son of God? Innocent? No, they don't have to because they're safe. But here this morning, you have to acknowledge Jesus Christ to be the Son of God. And Jesus said, if you will confess me before men, what? I'll confess you before my Father. See, you know, somebody said, well, no, when I get up there, I'll do my own confession. You won't be doing, you may be trying to, but you won't be able to. I know the Bible already said that every knee gonna bow and every tongue gonna confess, but your confession in the day of judgment won't be worth nothing. see, you got to do it before who? Before men. Amen. And then he said, what would I do? I'll confess you before my Father. Got to keep this thing right, isn't it?
Amen.
Confess before men. Well, that means I got to confess for people that I'm like that. Really, I really don't think they, you know, they ain't no better than I am. Some of them is not even living right. But he said, you got to do it before who? Men. Let people know that you believe Jesus Christ, the Son of God. And upon that confession, you're baptized. What will you do when you get baptized? You receive, as you come up out of the water, the gift of the Holy Spirit. Amen? Are we all on the same page here? So what then, unto what then were you baptized? They said unto John, that wasn't good enough. So they had to be baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And then, of course, they received the gift of the Holy Spirit. And the Bible tells us in that chapter, about verse number 6, say that were about 12 of them. But thank God,